Start this afternoon session with the presentation, which is the European Commission presentation. So ideally there would be somebody from the Commission to present this slide set. It is the what Tamás referred to as the big picture or the background or the context of why we are doing this. And so I don't really have to explain the slides so much after the very thorough and very intelligent discussion that we had this morning. So I think it was every minute of it was really useful, because that touched upon almost all the essential points and some of the difficult and delicate points as well. So I will run through this relatively quickly, where there is nothing special to add to the morning discussion. So we will here first outline the reason for supporting multilingualism, that the legal base, and then the more of the moral and cultural parts of the multilingualism mission as well, that we have it's multilingualism is actually in the legal basis of the European Union. It is in the treaties of the Union, the equality of the languages, and it is in the derived secondary legislation. So there is a famous regulation number one, the very first regulation of the European communities adopted was about the equality of the working languages. And this regulation has been updated every time that there has been an enlargement of the European Union. So there are different ways that the EU is supporting multilingualism, and it's the technical side of it is only one part, because there is support for language learning exchange programs. And there are, multilingualism also, the equality of languages and the right of the citizens to address the institutions in their own language is also written in the legislation, and something that we have to take seriously. And then we will show this slide about the evolution of the EU languages, because in the beginning, in year 1958, there were only 6 member states and there were only 4 official languages. Now there are 28 member states and 24 official languages. So these different colors or the different metro lines, each of them indicates a new wave of enlargements and a new wave of addition of languages. So then another part of the big picture of why we are promoting multilingual services in general, multilingual online services, multilingual internet, and not only multilingual, but cross-lingual. So that if I have a system available in Poland, it should be equally be available for people in Sweden. That's cross-linguality. Because multilinguality is just that you have multitude of languages, but I may not understand what is going on in each compartment. We want to bridge the barriers and make these compartments disappear. And our big motivator for this in the Commission, and this is what the current Juncker Commission has taken upon itself very seriously, is to create a digital single market. Now, a single market for the goods and services is already working relatively well and relatively open and without borders. But when you go to the digital space, when you go to e-commerce, when you go to satellite television, then there is no single market. There are still separate national markets. And one of the reasons why there is this compartmentation is, of course, is the language barrier, because you may easily order a product, a physical product from other country. You may use a local agent or representative, the whatever you are buying, the car set of kitchenware comes very easily. There is no problem in using it. You don't need to use you don't need language to use kitchenware, for example. Maybe the instructions have to be translated, but otherwise. But when you are doing business online, you are confronted with the language all the time, because you go to an e-commerce website. If it's in a language that you don't understand, your shopping stops right there. You will not shop in that e-commerce site. And you may think that Europeans are very proficient in languages. Well, that's true. That's true for the maybe 50% of Europeans. The other 50% only know their own language. 90% of Europeans want to use their own language when they are online, and especially when they are buying something, and especially if they are doing their banking, their online banking. They want to use their own language just to be sure that nothing terrible happens or nothing goes wrong. So this is where they may be proficient in English or other language, but they insist online to use, most of them insist using their own language. That's why the language barriers is a big barrier for the digital single market. And the point now behind the CEF automated translation is, that was already mentioned, that in many use situations that happen online, that human translation is too slow and or too expensive. You may use human translators to translate a statical website of your, but then when you have dynamic content which is constantly updated and regenerated, you have to use automated means, otherwise the content simply will not get translated. So this is sort of justification why we are bothering to do all this, why we are bothering to make the online systems multilingual. Just a sideline that our unit, we have been working on language technology solutions for many years. Since 2007, there was a wave of funding for language technology, and over 200 million euro has been invested. And there have been very good results in some areas, and machine translation is one of the promising the success stories of the funding program. So systems that arise from the results of this European research activity, it's thanks to research projects that we now have. For example, we have the MOSES platform, and MT at EC was created on that platform. So it's part of the positive results of this investment that was made in the earlier years. So then CEF Digital, and now it's maybe difficult to think, should be there more about CEF in the presentation after the discussion this morning? I think there maybe should more about CEF program. So this is now to explain that the CEF is the pan-European digital service infrastructure for cross-border online services like e-justice. The e-justice portal is already online, so you can have a look at it. E-procurement, so that I can participate in a call for tender that is launched in another country without being hampered by language barriers, obstacles. E-health, patients have become more and more mobile, and the national health systems in some situations, some countries, and sometimes they are overburdened, and it would help to be able to use health services across borders. Europeanized the digital library, which contains over 20 million digital objects. Some of them are books, texts, some of them are videos, works of art, and a lot of description of the items, so metadata about the items. So CEF is about deploying all these services. So it's not a research program, it's not innovation, it's about keeping these services, e-Justice, European Open Data Portal, keeping them running. So CEF has other parts, but we are here talking about the CEF digital. We are not talking about the CEF transport or the CEF energy. They are parts that are dealing with road networks and so on. We are talking here about CEF digital and especially the public services for the digital single market. So CEF is all about public services for the time being, at least. It's not about commercial services. So putting in place pan-European public services. Okay, and then there are a few items, again, justifications why these are considered necessary. Now we come to the part of the CEF program, which is automated translation. The simple task for the automated translation sounds simple, but it's difficult to do, of course. It will make all the European public online services multilingual. The idea is that these systems will have to serve the citizens everywhere in the EU, no matter which language they speak. And this will happen by deploying mature language technologies. So not technologies that are in prototype phase or research research phase, but technologies that are either in the market or on their way to the market that are performing. Then this is the part of the presentation that I feel should maybe would deserve a few more slides. Now I have only this one slide. What are these DSIs, these digital service infrastructures, which are the components of CEF digital? First of all, we have building blocks, which are services, DSIs that are serving all the other services. So they are like components of all of them. Identification, for example, in most systems, users there must be a way to identify who is using the system and in a secure way, unambiguous way, so that you can be sure who is trying to access the patient record, for example, or the tax declaration, who is giving a tax return. Automated translation belongs to this category of building blocks because it's actually serving the other DSIs. And then at the bottom of the screen are the DSIs that are served by the building blocks. Open Data Portal, Europeana Online Dispute Resolution System, e-procurement, e-health, safer internet, cybersecurity, then two new DSIs, the interconnection social security system, ESI, and the interconnection of the national business registers, BRIS. Now, very important reason why we actually put a lot of effort in making this happen in the member states, because we think that the member states have a really crucial role, as you have already understood so far in the discussion so far. Because more widely, we want the member states actually to take ownership of the program and not just say, okay, what can you give us in CEF? No, actually say, you should deliver this to me in CEF. This is what I want. That's the future picture that we want to see, so that your countries are not just taking what the Commission feeds them in CEF, but that one day you will be telling us what CEF should do, how it should do. So I'm dreaming of the day when this happens, and that's actually part of your mission as well. And the advantages, now this presentation is one of the first presentations. This comes early in the day. And somebody rightly said that it takes 6 hours before we get to the benefits. So that's why I put this one slide about the advantages already to this early presentation, because there's a whole one whole presentation about the advantages. But these we already highlighted in the discussion, so I don't really need to elaborate on that, but in fact, I think we need to be more concrete about the vision. I realize that for the CEF vision, for the longer term vision, what does it mean that the public services are online for all languages? Explain, give me examples. So it means, for example, that company in your country can participate in a call for tender launched by the let's say by the Spanish authorities, where all the tender documents are originally all in Spanish. Or citizens can find out about their rights in different countries, in when they are in different situations of their lives. So I feel that this slide set can be improved. So because this is where it ends now, but I feel more should be on the vision and maybe more on the CEF services. So the different e-health, e-procurement, what are they? What language multilinguality requirements are there in each of them? But again, of course, it will complicate and maybe make this presentation a bit longer, but I feel that there's some need to. That was it. Do you have questions to this presentation?
Hi. My question is, to what extent is there scope for changing the pitch of this particular talk? And so I understand we can change the order of the agenda. And the reason is that I think Irish is a very different case to a lot of other languages, in that the digital market and the benefits for the digital market isn't actually relevant in our case. So every Irish speaker is a fluent English speaker. So they have access then to the other MT systems to access whatever they need. So the idea of e-procurement being available is not relevant in terms of Irish machine translation. Our need is more to meet the public demand for every all material needs to be in both languages, official documents. And that's to do with the status of Irish as an official minority language. So I don't know if that question is clear, but I think the pitch of this talk will be lost on our audience to some extent, and I think Josef would understand.
That's a very good comment, yeah. I subscribed to that you cannot really sell with the same arguments. It's true that, you know, Irish companies can sell in English in large part of Europe, but not to all the 500 million Europeans. So that's the point. You will lose half of them immediately, half of them because they don't speak a word of English. You might think it's different, but that's the grim reality. We have realized this by surveys, like Eurobarometer surveys, so that we have really been investigating this, the true language proficiency of Europeans. So even for the English-speaking companies, it will, you know, increase the reach out, and especially people, as I said, are reluctant to buy when it comes to buying using your credit card. So even using English, the small elite of Europeans who are using their credit cards online with English-speaking sites, it's not that large as you might think. You know, it is in the order of 10-15% of the European EU population. So that's about the market size. And then, but of course, the Irish versus English language brings the special flavor, of course, to Ireland, because this is a very local issue, and it's not really an issue that there is so much e-commerce in Irish. There I agree fully with you that you don't need to worry about that, because people in Ireland will do their shopping in English, no problem. But it's about the European market space, maybe more about that potential. Yeah, it should be. This is exactly what should be customized. So I thought this European Commission presentation doesn't need that much customization, but actually you're right, it does.
And I think you could add things like equitability, like, you know, equal chances for all the official European languages, no matter how many speakers. Although this might be a bit too bleak, this sort of like digital oblivion or danger of digital oblivion in the digital age for the smaller languages, etc. You'll have to decide, but I think I would, I would keep the single digital market and then just add to it and say kind of like, okay, like one aspect might not be so relevant, but of course selling is relevant because many people don't speak English. So we get the same problem. And then you have this sort of like equal chances, you know, nobody, no language should be disadvantaged against, you know, and this sort of like, this danger of oblivion in the digital age.